Assalamu alaikum, hello, and welcome to The Health Show, here only on the Islam Channel with me, Alistair Greener. Now, The Health Show aims to cover all matters concerning your health, and we want to keep you informed and healthy. We also want our viewers to be comfortable, so you may feel a little shy discussing some of the topics, but we do encourage you to talk about these issues, and we'll do our best to answer your questions. Now, this week, we'll be taking a slightly different approach to the show, so we won't be taking any of your phone calls. So please don't call in today. But as usual, if you'd like any further information on the show or any of the topics that we're going to be discussing, please do email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Now, we must stress that should you suffer from any medical problems, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as The Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. Now, today we're focusing on obstetrics and gynaecology, looking into the female sexual health and the reproductive system. And to help us with today's topic, I'd like to welcome Henna Khan, an obstetrician and gynaecologist. She's a fellow member at the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists in London. She specialises in reproductive and sexual health, and we're really happy that she's agreed to discuss issues related to pregnancy, miscarriage, management of STIs, contraceptions and hysterectomies with us today. Thank you so much for coming in. Lots to talk about today, so
You're
we will
welcome.
Get straight on to it. But thank you very
Thanks
much indeed. Me. But before we talk more to Ms Khan in just a few moments, let's have a look at some interesting topics that we've noticed with family planning and some of the pros and cons of women taking contraception in Kenya.
This is a family planning workshop in northeast Kenya, a poor and conservative part of the country where most people are ethnic Somalis. Only 2% of the population here use contraception, compared to the national Kenyan average of 58%. Women are often married before reaching the age of 18.
I started to use family planning to be in better health, and so my children would be in better health too. Before I started spacing out my children, I was very unwell. At the start of my pregnancy, I would get sharp pains during childbirth too. Today, I'm much better.
The improvements to Sophia's health are largely thanks to an awareness program launched by Save the Children in 2014.
We make them aware of the importance of family planning, the importance of child spacing, aware of the effects of early marriages. We also make them aware of the effects of female genital mutilation.
But getting their message across is challenging. In Somali culture, large families are a sign of wealth, and the average woman gives birth to 8 children.
African culture, people used to get several wives and get a lot of children. So they have seen this as a foreign ideology, foreign idea. In order to limit their number so that they can colonize them.
The program's message also clashes with religious norms, with many believing family planning is forbidden by Islam. The NGO seeks the help of influential religious leaders to help combat reservations. Following several weeks of reflection and after receiving the blessing of her husband, Fatuma has decided to use a contraceptive implant.
Using family planning is a personal decision, and given that my religion accepts it, I'm going to use it.
After just 2 years, the results from the awareness drive are encouraging. Like Fatuma, more than 3,000 women started using contraception this year, more than double the number from the year before.
So, again, it's lovely to have you on the show. Thank you very much indeed for coming in. I know you're Thanks someone who's very, very busy. Now, we saw there about contraception and family planning. In many cultures, this is still something that is a bit of a taboo subject. It's not discussed maybe as much as it should be.
That's right, yeah. And I think it's about education and awareness. And I would say that currently, like, including our countries, Asian countries or Muslim countries, they are much, much better than 10 years ago. And they understand, individually people have been using in their families. The idea which comes from Islamic background is that it should not be forced upon people or make it as a, a national campaign or a government campaign. But people should be aware of it. So according to their family situation, financial backgrounds, or other considerations, what the husband is doing, what's the wife working or studying or whatever, they can make plans. And then there's a lot of stress in Quran about bringing up the child with breastfeeding for at least 2 years. Try to do that, which there's no replacement for breastfeeding.
Let's just come
That's
back.
How it brings contraception into it.
So let's come back to the whole issue of contraception. What are some of the reasons why in some cultures and in some parts of the world where contraception isn't as proactive as maybe it should be?
Yeah, there is some religious background to that, that if you believe as from divine religion that everything happens with God's will, so do not interfere in it. That was the original concept, and still some religions have that. But with time and education, people have come to this understanding and awareness that although God controls everything, but he has given you a mind and he has given you this understanding about your own situation and surroundings. So without harming your body and without harming your family, if you can do it in a way, like there are some hormones which may not suit some ladies, so they have to see and their doctor has to see.
And again, there are many different methods of contraception that people can use. And again, I suppose that's a perfect opportunity to go and see someone like yourself and get advice on what method of contraception is going to work best for you.
That's right, because, and like we were saying, if you even go to the times before, at the time of the Prophet, for example, if you are pointing towards the Muslim culture or Catholic culture, at the time of Prophet, peace be upon him as well, some companions came to him about this issue and they did discuss him and asked him about, for example, the very simple natural way of withdrawal method, because at that time there were no hormones and other things available at the time. But in Chinese culture, you see, once we were doing an operation and after hysterectomy, sometimes we cut the uterus, because we are sending it to pathology and we look inside if there's any obvious tumor or not. And we found a small ring there. So that ring was inserted as a contraception at some stage. So you find that in Chinese culture that the wedding rings were inserted inside to keep it, to use as a coil.
And of course, the whole issue of contraception isn't just about unwanted pregnancies. It's also about having, you know, healthy sexual health, isn't it?
Healthy sexual health, I would say more in a family setup, because there's a small child, for example, a few months baby, you are breastfeeding, you're looking after that, and if you're working as well, there are lots of other issues, and you want a happy family, then you would decide for at least some time or 2 years until when the baby is breastfeeding to have a little gap, isn't it? It won't naturally, naturally what happens, the setup of hormones, that's the way God has created us and he's the best planner, that the hormones, oxytocin, which are released during breastfeeding, they suppress the pregnancy hormones anyway. So there's a very little chance of pregnancy.
Let's talk a little bit about sexual health for a moment. We'll come to the subject of hysterectomies and other aspects of female health in a while. But coming back to STIs, this is one of the things that, again, is a bit of a taboo, isn't it? That sometimes people feel embarrassed to talk about it. Although it's getting better, especially in Britain, it's still something we don't talk about enough, possibly.
Yeah, I mean, there have been times, and I've been working in NHS since back in 90s, and I remember the times when we had to do our 8 family planning sessions. We didn't even call it sexual health sessions, in some back street clinics, somewhere hidden, you know. But now, over the past 20 years, we see that they have come to the front of the streets, because you cannot just hide away from the issues you have. There are young people suffering from it. It's the culture of mixing and everything. So if this is the result, then you have to deal with it.
And one of the big issues, of course, is sometimes people think that, well, I know I don't have that many partners, so therefore my risk is lower. But of course, you don't always know about the history of your partner.
That's right, yeah. We have to take it two way. For example, I was in my gynecology and obstetrics practice as a special advanced training skill module. I was interested in sexual and reproductive health, because in gynae I saw so many issues relating to this, and lots of my colleagues were doing fetal medicine, ultrasound and all the common ones, and I wanted to do something different. And in my trust and hospital. At the time, I was the first one to initiate the advanced training skill module in sexual health. And there I found that, then I initiated a small study which was called FEARS, F-E-A-R-S, FEARS associated with reproductive and sexual health. And whatever I found from there, from my pilot study of 50 patients, I have compared it with my recent overseas experience in the Middle East during my sabbatical leave, and I compared it with the Saudi culture and ladies. Here we were talking about multiple partners, and there we saw that the ladies don't have multiple partners, but their husbands have multiple partners, which is more than one wife, possibly, which is declining now. So the issue is still the same. So you cannot hide away from it. But it is, I found it there that it's not open to have sexual health clinics. So I have luckily been able to implement the Royal College guidelines in a remote hospital in Saudi Arabia.
Let's talk a little bit about those guidelines in terms of the things that people can do to protect themselves for better female health and better sexual health. What are some of the key things that people can do themselves?
Yeah, first of all, awareness, as like you are trying to do. I have always been, despite working at hospital setup in a specialty, I have always been trying to be a champion of community. My colleagues always knew it, and some of my seniors, God bless them, they have encouraged me to that as well. And today's NHS situation is telling us that we are going on to that line. So first of all, awareness, and it is my responsibility as a lay person, if I am a lay person, I'm just a public person, to keep myself aware, not just to wait for the GP that my cervical cancer screening letter will come and then I will go. Before that, to be aware that what are the situations which can expose me to having sexual health infection.
And let's say you have something that you think is slightly wrong. What kind of things should women be noticing about their bodies that would indicate something's not right?
Yeah, I mean, if there is a... all the ladies, they have some sort of vaginal discharge, but if there is changes in that, color changing or irritation or itching or pain with that, something unusual, and a woman will know because she has been aware of her own body, then there are lots of facilities in this country. We are lucky. There are walk-in clinics, sexual health clinics in every area in London streets and in remote areas as well. And if we don't want to go there, like you said, in some cultures it's a taboo to go and attend a sexual health clinic, we can always talk to our GP. And if we don't want to talk to a male GP, then the nurses are available and we can request to have a nurse appointment. And if not all of that, then at least now, you know, in every year we say that there's a Prophet Google. Prophet Google is available in every house, more or less.
And the real key is to ask. If you're unsure about something, just ask.
Yeah, of course. Instead of just hiding it to yourself or feeling embarrassed, there are many family situations where people would think in that way.
Let's talk more generally about sort of female health and the sort of things that we can do to ensure that we're more healthy. So, for example, how big a role in specifically female health does nutrition have?
Yeah, now, as we know that a female, when she's a teenager as well, or she's a little girl, or even from 7 years of age, the ovaries start getting active and eggs start formed. This whole process, the industry of a human creation starts working because she is going to be a part of a very, very big phenomena. So it's the parents' responsibility as well to keep the girls active in sports. She's healthy, her pelvic joints and muscles, they are all nice and lax and flexible, because she has to go through a time when she will need all these, this passage for the birth. And then she should not be anemic. The calcium and iron levels are low in quite a few cultures' backgrounds because of our nutritional habits and all. And the other thing is, some sports, she has to be very careful. Like, you know, we say, oh, we are free, we are not different from men, so why can't I just go and do bungee jumping and things like that? But we have to be very careful that if our pelvic bone breaks, then there can be lots and lots of problems at the time of delivery. I always tell them that it's not about the difference in that sense. It's about the role you'll play in your age later on.
And what about the conversations you should be having with your children as your girls are getting older? What are those conversations that you should be having?
Yeah, like, for example, I can give my own example. I have two girls and they had no problem going through the changes of puberty and then getting married and after that getting pregnant and childbirth, because at every stage it has been like a table talk about the changes our bodies are going through, and we have not made it like a taboo that she cannot come to the mom and discuss about it. If there are pubertical changes happening in the body of a female body particularly. And I think not only female, even because when we do sexual health clinics, there are boys, young boys attending as well, who cannot talk to their parents, mom and dad. They cannot discuss about the changes they are sensing in their body. So there should be that relationship which we say about every other thing as well, a very comfortable relationship between parents and children, that when they are entering into teenage, they can discuss and the dangers they could be exposed to, isn't it?
Would you say it's the teenage years when that's the most important time
even
to start
before,
that conversation?
I would say even before, like from 9 years old as well, because when they enter into teenage, then they actually go on into the puberty, isn't it? So even before that, when we are preparing them for other things, like if we are on Islam channel, so if I talk about a Muslim, typical Muslim family, so we do talk to them about the wudu, the prayer, how to keep yourself clean, the hygiene. That is the time that we can start putting these little tips in as well about the private parts, and because we do talk about it, the cleanliness of the private parts and the unwanted hair cleanliness, which all comes from the Abrahamic culture about personal hygiene. That's the time when we can mention, for example, talking about circumcision, that how it's hygienic and how it has helped to keep yourself clean. So what are the other things like sexual transmitted infections which can then again destroy your hygiene once again and expose you to very, very dangerous sort of infections. It's not only about, oh, we are trying to put restrictions. The children should not feel that we are just trying to put restrictions because we are Muslims and it's Islamic religion, you shouldn't have girlfriends, boyfriends. No, we have to tell them medically as well, because that is what Islam is. It is a religion of nature. And why these restrictions are there? Because these are the consequences.
And again, it's having that open conversation which is so important. And one of the things you touched on there was about nutrition, and in some parts of the world where nutrients there maybe
deficient,
not as they're deficient in, and that can have consequences. First of all, what are those nutrients? Where can they get them? And what are the consequences if they don't have them?
Yeah, for example, let's take simple thing of calcium and iron. Like even in UK, the ladies, the families who have migrated from other countries like us, India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, genetically they seem to have less amount of calcium. They seem to lack calcium and iron for nutritional deficiency. So in pregnancy, they are given iron and calcium. So the
they have them in supplement form.
In supplement form.
Right.
And because most of them, their tests which are done initially in the beginning, in the first trimester of the pregnancy, show that they are deficient. And when I worked in Saudi Arabia as well, again, the vitamin D deficiency, and you could say part of a dress-up as well. But here in this country, for example, you hardly have sun half the year, you don't have it. And on top of that, the nutrition's obviously for calcium, they should be having like nuts and milk products, all those things in which there is natural source of calcium. And they can, again, awareness comes there. They should be looking for it themselves as well on internet and from their GP. And then iron is in apple and spinach, all the green leafy vegetables, and
all the things we know that are good for us, but we probably don't eat
enough of. Nutrition, yeah. In every culture, the women know, like, again, in I noticed that in Saudi Arabia, they just have one solution to anemia. They will immediately buy lots of black raisins, and they say the black raisins is the solution to their anemia, and very quickly their iron level, that's what I learned from their shoots, very high, very quickly. So here we see that we can eat apples and other fruits, carrots.
And what about, for women at a stage where they're ready to get pregnant, they want to have a child, what are some of the key things they should be doing with their health at that point? Is there any nutrient they need more of that will help their fertility and the possibility of conceiving?
Yeah, I'm good that you touched that. I'm happy you touched that point, because that's called perinatal period, which is like just before that. And actually planning at that time, because sometimes one is that the partner and herself, husband, wife, both should visit their doctor or health visitor, because there are some things, for example, if anemia is there, there could be another reason that there is a thalassemia trait there. It is not thalassemia, but one gene is linked from one side. So the partner will have to be checked that he doesn't have it, because then the risk of having a thalassemia child will rise. There will be a risk of having a thalassemia baby. And the doctors have to be prepared for that beforehand. And besides, they need to know some other links of that as well, that they don't have a genetic link of those infections or diseases. And then there could be a possibility that one of the mother, she has high blood pressure or diabetes, and this is the time, and that all has to be controlled even before getting into pregnancy. And then while they are planning, they have to, she has to start taking folic acid to avoid the congenital abnormalities which could occur in the spinal cord.
And again, so it's folic acid. The old adage of being forewarned is forearmed, isn't
exactly
it?
Exactly, forewarned is forearmed.
And
prevention rather than treatment, like, you know, the basic rule, the golden rule.
Let's talk about treatment for a second. First of all, coming back to STIs and things like that, a lot of people, their nervousness of going to see a specialist is, well, what's treatment going to be? How long is it going to be? Is it as bad as I think it is? Obviously, we've established just go and ask, but typically, how easy is it to overcome these problems with medication?
Yeah, the medication for the STIs, you mean?
Yeah.
More or less for everything, medication is available now. Whether you take it chlamydia, if it is diagnosed, you know, there's a lot of stress on having yourself screened in the schools, the colleges, universities also, it's offered and free test for chlamydia. So people should be screened because there is treatment available, and when they take it, their partner has to take it as well. So the partner will be screened as well. So if it's done in time, and again, prevention is better than treatment. They are told about the preventive methods and keep your relationship within your own relationship and not to spread it so that you are spreading the STI to everybody else. And the protective methods and everything. And similarly, even for gonorrhea, although it's a difficult disease to be treated when it's active, but there is medication, but it's a lot of stress, a lot of burden on NHS, especially if people who think, oh my God, I have slept with somebody who may have HIV, and now that person is very scared and he or she wants to come and have preventive medicine. That means it's a £500 of burden on NHS for just 1 month for that one person.
That's the interesting thing, isn't it? Because the taboo is often people say, oh, I won't go, I won't bother the doctor, but actually if they don't and it turns out to be something, actually you're going
That's
to be far
it.
More of a burden than if you have gone for a checkup in the first place.
Rather, when I was, I used to sit in the sexual health clinic, once I told my director, I said, can you supply me some robes and the holy water and bread? He said, why? I said, because everyone is entering with the, oh, I have some confession to make. And then that person is so scared, then you have to spend another 10 minutes to reassure them that this, no, don't worry, you haven't got AIDS, you can't catch it like this, unless this, these are the points that are possible that that person was at high risk. Like it already has multiple partners and all, or it was a high-risk area, like central London is very high-risk now. Once we were in a Piccadilly Circus for a particular workshop for 3 days for sexual health infection.
We have just a few more minutes before we go to break, but I just wanted to touch on something which we're going to be talking about more after the break, and that's hysterectomies. It's something that we hear a lot about, and it's almost that word of people, it strikes fear in most people. Tell us a little bit about exactly what it is and where it's most common. At what sort of age is it most common?
Yeah. Hysterectomy means getting rid of the uterus. It could be with or without ovaries, that the or the cervix as well. And mostly it's the middle age, from after 40 to 50 and then less after 60. But in a year, in UK itself, there could be up to 55,000 hysterectomies which have been performed, and all over the world, globally, 1.2 million. Like in US, it's a much higher number, 66.
And of course, it's something that women are going to feel, it's very personal to undergo that sort of operation. But from the numbers you're saying, it's actually quite normal and very, certainly very common.
Yeah, now it is getting less common, actually. It was more. Even now, it's like 1 out of 5 people who could be at risk of having it, ladies who could be at risk of having it in their
lifetime.
And is
that because the treatments
but now the
are
alternative,
better to
prevent? Yeah, alternative treatments have come now, like laser, just burning the lining of the endometrium with something else so you don't have to get the uterus out itself, unless there's a tumor which are called like benign tumors or cancer tumors, and there are other reasons that the rest of the medication or hormones are not working. Like even coils are used as treatment now. There are certain types of coils.
But again, if somebody is given the news that they are going to need a hysterectomy, it's nothing to be completely frightened of.
Not particularly. They are then made aware of the risks. Like it is a surgery anyway. So any surgery and under general anesthesia, the complications of anesthesia itself, and then of the major surgery. So we explain all the risks, because the risk could be low or high. If it's like 1 in 100, it's very high.
But well, we'll be talking more about that in a while, but I'm afraid at the moment it's time for a short break. But when we return, we will be talking more to Ms. Khan, and in fact, talking of hysterectomies, one of her patients. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Hello and welcome back to The Health Show, where our topic today is on obstetrics and gynaecology. So far, we've discussed with Henna Khan some of the issues related to female sexual health and the reproductive system. In a moment, we'll be introducing one of Ms. Khan's patients, Sahida Malik, who'll be talking about her personal experience having undergone a hysterectomy. But first, let's see a video from South Africa about their fight against HIV and protecting a younger generation.
Lebogang Matsumi is HIV positive, infected by a man 10 years her senior. For years, she dated sugar daddies, older men who shower young women with presents and cash in return for sex. In South Africa, they've been dubbed blessers, although they're often anything but.
It was not now love and comfort. I knew if I'm with this guy, I will get so much money and I will fulfill my wants. I want to fit in. I want to wear this sneaker because my friend is wearing it. I want to have this hair because my friend has it. And it comes from not loving yourself enough and accepting who you are and knowing that you are not determined by your current circumstance.
South African girls aged 15 to 19 are up to 8 times more likely to be HIV positive than boys the same age. And an estimated 2,000 young women here are being infected every week. Scientists believe intergenerational relationships are driving a cycle of infections. And in South Africa, sugar daddies have become public enemy number one.
And to the blessers, there is only one level I want. The zero level, zero tolerance for men. We put adolescent girls at risk for HIV.
The South African government recently launched a prevention campaign aimed at empowering girls to help keep them away from older men. But it's vital getting the whole community on board, including their parents.
Many parents are in denial. I don't blame them. Every parent wants to believe their daughter is doing nothing. It's an angel sitting. But this is natural. The parents themselves forgot that they did indulge in sex, whether before or after marriage, but they did because they are human beings.
Lebogang says she suffered from a lack of information both at home and school. Today she insists adults have real conversations with teenagers rather than speaking in slogans.
Young people don't want to be preached at, don't want to be judged, but the information you give them and how you treat them at the end of the day sort of influences how they see life and how they want to live. But if we say sugar daddies must fall, stay away from sugar daddies, you've lost people that you could have been making so much impact.
Lebogang is now herself a mother and uses her experiences to teach young women about the risks of relationships with older men. Her advice, a condom is non-negotiable, be it with a boyfriend or a blesser.
Really, really interesting again. And we are joined, as I mentioned earlier, by Sahida Malik. And it's great to have you in the studio. Thank you very much indeed
nice
for coming in.
Me.
What you have been through is not particularly uncommon. It's not necessarily particularly pleasant, obviously.
Yes, I am.
But it is something that happens to a lot of women. You gave us some statistics there before the break. Tell us a little bit about your story. First of all, how did you find out that this might actually have to happen?
Actually, it's 8 years ago. I started a very heavy period. And I'm going time to time doctor and complaining. And they give me sometimes tablets. And
then didn't tell?
No, they didn't tell me. And then I'm pushing them because NHS, sorry about that, it's not quick service. Then 3-4 years, I'm suffering. Even I can't plan any holidays. I really suffering my family life, because when my period come, I just go to the bed. Mm-hmm. Heavy period, even bed sheets sometimes.
Flooding.
And I can't plan.
Pain as well.
And especially migraine come to the, my head.
So you're in a lot of discomfort.
You had thyroid problems.
Oh, I had underactive thyroid as well.
Yeah, that can cause actually very heavy periods.
Yeah.
Affects the hormones.
So yeah. At what point did your GP or whoever it was decide, actually, we need to look more into this?
Actually, 4 years ago, then I push again. Doctor, they said, oh, don't worry, you're going to be soon menopause. It's going to be, yeah, it's
so
going
stay
to
like that,
yeah,
for that stay there.
You have only 2-3 fibroids. I said, I understand, but this is going to, I'm going through, because lost in blood, family life, myself, I feel awful, I feel depressed, and because I can't do anything, I can't plan, because after 20 days, my periods come.
So eventually, they decided to do something about it. What was it about your condition that convinced them that you needed a hysterectomy?
I convinced them they not. Then they inserted me, you know, the coil, a Marina coil?
Mm-hmm. Marina.
They
well.
Said, then 1 year I put Marina coil is more than worse. Mm. I feel not helping at
all. So they tried a few different things.
Yeah.
They didn't work.
No.
And then eventually they agreed with you that actually a hysterectomy was the only option.
If I interrupt here, that's the time where I came. That's why I'm saying being a champion of the community, that I was doing a voluntary clinic after Friday prayers in the local mosque. And that's through where Zahida contacted me, that she has been going through this and the GPs has been giving her different things. It's not working, but they are just buying time, really. And she doesn't think that she has been treated as she should have been. The problem is still there. So that's why I told her the ways which can be opted now, the referral to the gynecology, and from there, what are the options to look at. But at that time, I think you traveled as well to Pakistan.
I traveled to
and
Lebanon.
You saw
I traveled
Lebanon.
To Lebanon.
Okay.
Because my husband then take me to special gynecologists there as well. Maybe we need some solution to fix this
and
problem.
I suppose often even within the NHS, you can always ask for a second opinion if you're
That's
not
right.
happy
now we have
with facility. The response you're getting.
Yeah.
But they do something as well there in Lebanon as well. They put, I think, DNC something. It's cleaning my wombs kind of things.
They did it.
Yeah,
that's a minor procedure.
Yeah.
To take a layer of the endometrium away for some time.
I done this one.
Gives a relief.
But no work. Didn't work anything.
So fast forwarding to the point that, you know, with your involvement, you're going to go ahead with the hysterectomy.
Yeah.
Tell us about for women who may be watching, who are thinking, I think I might end up having a hysterectomy.
Yeah.
Talk through the process from the moment, you know, the preparations and through the operation. Tell us how that was.
It was a bit scary, to be honest.
Sure.
I'm not quite happy to go through for this, but I have no option. Then I go to the doctor and they refer me to gynecologist. Then she decided to do.
Because you had fibroid as well.
Yeah, I have a fibroid, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then she said, no, I check your old result. Better you go through this operation. And then I said, okay, go ahead.
So how long, you obviously had to wait a period to be able to get an appointment to actually have the operation. Beforehand, you obviously, like most operations, I presume, weren't able to eat for a day or something.
Yes, of course.
And then how long were you actually in hospital?
I was staying 5 to 6 days.
Okay.
But still, I'm not stable to come home. But there, I'm not comfortable. Better stay home rather than hospital. And believe me, they said 6 weeks to recovery, but it's not.
It's I'm not almost, 6 weeks, it has to be 12 weeks.
Now, almost I'm 12 weeks, but still I am.
Feel a bit tired.
I have
tired
pain, lower.
She had
again,
abdominal, she had the one
it's
with
like
the cut in the tummy.
Okay.
That's why.
So there are different methods
it
of.
It could be just vaginal without any cut, but everybody can't have it. It has to be after. Children's after a childbirth, 3 or 4 children, the pelvic ligaments are lax and it's easy to get the uterus from the bottom. So those if the muscles are tight and ligaments are also still like a bit young, then they have to go from the top. But now a new thing is laparoscopic hysterectomy as well. There are very few places where it is being done. where with the keyhole surgery.
So it's not quite as invasive as before.
Yeah, it's combined with vaginal and laparoscopic.
So the surgery that you had was probably the most invasive form of surgery.
Yeah, abdominal.
And again, that obviously took a while to overcome. So how long after the surgery was it when you felt that you were okay again?
Now I feel better. See, after 12 weeks.
12 weeks?
Yes.
You're driving now.
After 8 weeks, I start driving.
Okay.
But first 3 weeks, I am in different world, believe me, mentally and physically.
Although with the painkillers as well.
And what about now? Now that you've had it done, and you think back to how you were before you had it done, I'm presuming that this was, without question, the right thing to do.
Yes, I understand,
For the discomfort of, say, 12 weeks versus a lifetime when you're going to be okay.
Yeah, I'm a bit happy now because when I think about it, it's not 20 days after this monster thing's coming out and I'm disturbing me. I'm quite happy now, feeling.
And that's someone who's had the most invasive. So there's a good chance that for any of our viewers watching who have to undergo a hysterectomy, it might not be as invasive. So actually, we've given them possibly the toughest case scenario.
Yeah.
But in Zahida's case, the other thing which happened was, is the flip side of it is that she went through surgical menopause, about which she wasn't very well prepared. And I do teach junior doctors and all, and I tell them even the middle grades as well, that when they go for consent, they have to discuss all that in the patient's language, in a pre-op clinics, that's why we have it. That if we are taking your ovaries out as well, for example, if you're 48 years old, after 2-3 years, you're having menopause, we rather take ovaries out as well so that they don't develop a cancer or tumor in future. Mm-hmm. But that will be a severe, sudden drop of estrogen hormones and progesterone, and you'll go through a surgical menopause, it's called. So then you would have hot flushes and night sweating,
starting now.
Relationship will be affected. So that was quite a shock for Zahida.
Yeah.
And I had to go through all that with her as well again.
Much.
So it is very important that someone guides you through so that you know what to expect, because as you quite rightly say, it's not just the pure physicality of having the hysterectomy, it's all of the associated elements.
And to plan beforehand that you will need hormone replacement, because we are taking away your hormones suddenly. So you will need hormone replacement in one way or the other. What's your family history? Whether
of course, if you go through the menopause, it's over a period of time where this is just very sudden.
That's right. This is very sudden, yeah.
And looking back now, do you just wish this you had had this earlier?
You better had this operation earlier instead of suffering 8 years.
Yes, I'm a bit angry.
Because even Myrina didn't help, although Myrina does help
me. Yeah, they're trying on, my body is different.
But because you had fibroids as well. She has muscle tumours inside, benign tumours, which then do not let even the something like Myrina, which is releasing hormones, progesterone to support ovaries, is not working because of the surface not being even inside the uterus.
Again, it's not an easy decision to make, which I suppose is why you need to really get as much advice as you possibly can from different people.
And get involved with your treatment,
And there's a lot of backup. I mean, you were talking there about the community work that you do.
That's right. That's where I catch these patients who come through the, loopholes. Mm-hmm. That's where I interact with them, or we just bump into each other somewhere. If you're working in the community, then they will find you or you will find them.
You said earlier on that sometimes the reason to have a hysterectomy is because a tumour's been found like that. So it's often closely related to cancers of that part of the body, isn't it?
Yeah, cancer could happen as well, but there are risk factors. Like if you look at the recent statistics, three patients were from age 5 to 14 as well who had hysterectomy. You could never imagine that. Mm-hmm. But because there would have been a tumour, there is a familial genetic condition, Lynch syndrome, in which there could be tumours or cancers of certain parts of the body. So patients, it is removed because of a tumour, a cancer, then we suggest that pathologist must look for Lynch syndrome as well, that patient is not genetically at risk of having cancer of different parts of the body.
Talking of cancer, very, very quickly, I know you're involved in a charity, aren't you, that, which is why we have a hat on the table. So tell us very, very briefly, we've only got a little bit of time, but tell us very briefly about this, because again, it's a great support for
women who are going through this.
For women who are going through this and who might wind up with a hysterectomy as a result. So tell us very briefly about it.
Yeah, thank God that Zahida's pathology came completely normal. There was no cancer in that. But after age 40, if any lady is having heavy period, she should have PIPEL, which is a smaller biopsy, which can be done at the GP or at the hospital to exclude that. But the cat, this head actually presents, some of us doctors, we made a small charity quite a long time ago, 10 years ago, and it's called basically Serving Humanity. It's a wing of our other charity, Renaissance Readers Club UK, which looks at education of public against fake news and misconceptions and bringing communities together, bridging the gaps, you know, the things which are happening in the world. And part of it is Serving Humanity. And we have a page on Facebook, Serving Humanity Slough, where we then take different things, like recently around the New Year and Boxing Day, we have been feeding homeless from the mosque and as a mobile service in the area, finding them.
And the hat is all
but
about
hat is
people.
All about the ladies who go through God forbid they have been found as cancer and they go through chemotherapy and they lose their hair. So we set up a coffee morning where they wear their hats and come, and then we reward them. The one who's wearing the best hat of the day, she gets a reward.
And that's a very nice, very, very nice hat.
This is okay, thank you.
But obviously, yes, as we said, you know, having a hysterectomy can be a result of lots of different things. What would you say, Zahida, to women who have just received the news that the chances are this is going to be the best treatment for them? What would you say?
Yeah, it's good if go through. Better not to suffer like me.
Go ahead. And you certainly won't be the first, and you certainly won't be the last.
Of course, yes, it's true.
And what about after the operation and you got home? Did you have to do any form of sort of exercises, or was there anything that you had to do?
Yes, I'm starting now for walk a little bit.
And you were given some exercises as well?
No, they did not recommend anything.
For recovery?
It was just about slowly getting yourself to become more active again, was it?
Yes.
Okay. Even after total hysterectomy, after a few weeks, they should be doing some pelvic floor, just like after childbirth. So because there's still a risk that from the vault of the vagina, it could just drop and cause prolapse again, even without uterus.
Wow.
So there could be complications, and they have to
I
have.
I didn't know this.
And then diet and nutrition to avoid these menopausal symptoms. Although she's going to have a patch, estrogen patch, which has less risk of breast cancer.
Let's talk about that very briefly. We've got just enough time to do this, because there will be, again, viewers who are going through the menopause at the moment.
That's right, yeah.
And want to
have a whole show
minimize
about
the impact of it. So what sort of things can they be doing nutritionally to help them mitigate those symptoms?
I would recommend we have a whole show about it, but for now, just briefly, that just general health tips, like avoiding common things like smoking and alcohol, is a very good milestone towards that. And then what you are eating, know what I'm eating, not like in a rush, any fast food or every day, having enough water, natural things in my diet.
Are there particular foods that are good for dealing with menopausal symptoms?
Now, there are lots of herbal things which has come, like there's some berry product which has been proposed, and also St. John Wort's. But if that is people are taking for depression, then they have to see that how it interacts. And for example, the black seeds and the dates, in different cultures it's different. I'm talking about Muslim culture, that dates, honey, black seeds, these are the things which give general immunity to your body. And as long as your general immunity is good, any of the symptoms can be controlled better.
And obviously, as we always advocate on this show, always speak to your doctor before you're thinking about trying different things.
Yeah,
but generally, there are some foods, therefore, that you can
use. Yeah, because menopause can also affect the bones. You know, you keep hearing in grandmas or they're breaking their bones suddenly while going to the toilet. So because their bones get weak very quickly, so they have to have things which keep their bones strong, not waiting for menopause, even from younger age, like from 20s and 30s, we have to be more careful that we are taking enough calcium, because after menopause, the calcium will not give that effect anymore. You will need other things to support that.
Now, we've talked a lot today about different aspects of female health. We've talked about sexual health, we've talked about contraception a little bit, and hysterectomies. What other areas of female health should women be particularly aware of?
I think, as you said, pregnancy as well, isn't it? That for pregnancy and during the pregnancy, what are the things which will then be, which could be a problem for them? For example, we talked about folic acid and all, which they should be taking in the periconceptional time. Or epilepsy, if a patient is epileptic, she has to be aware that there are certain medications she'll need a change. Or mental health, that if she's already on antidepressants and things, there will be again a change required at this time, that during pregnancy there will be certain she can take and certain she could still keep on. So she will need some input from the mental health side. And if there's a heart disease, congenital heart disease, or she has had problems, or then the doctor has to know about it. She must tell the doctor about it beforehand, and she will be taken care of beforehand. Or if there's any genetic condition in the family.
Is it folklore, is it actually true that women, when it comes to anemia, women are more susceptible to anemia than men?
In certain parts of the world. Here, I would say not particularly, because the nutrition is good, the diet is good, everyone is up to the mark, especially the Caucasians. Yes, women could be more susceptible, again, because of the amount of blood they lose on a monthly basis, if it is excessive. And then in childbirth, there's a lot of blood loss. And even when she's breastfeeding, the baby is sucking a lot of iron and calcium out of the mom's body. So at every stage, she is losing and using it a lot. So she needs a replacement if it's not up to the mark. So it's very common to keep checking the iron levels at different trimesters of the pregnancy.
Now, coming to your specific profession with obstetrics and gynecology, obviously, that's a specific area of training, and anybody coming to you is going to come to you knowing that you've got all of this fantastic experience. How long does it take to get to that point of your career that you develop all of this amazing knowledge?
My experience with obs and gyne goes back to about 30 years now. But when we started, only if you look at the British system of training, here what I obviously did my basic MBBS from Pakistan back in 1987. And then in 2000, I had the membership from the Royal College of Obstetricians, like post-graduation from here. And then the fellowship in 2013. But if you go by the system here, then after the graduation from the medical school, they go through a training system of, you know, F1 and F2, which is the foundation years. And then they go into the specific training from the Royal College, which is a specialist training, ST.
One, two, three, four, five.
Another five years. So altogether 7 years, even after the graduation.
Wow.
But not everybody gets into that training. That's the thing. National training number is very, it's not easy to get. There's a lot of competition, merit. Otherwise, we go into the middle grade system of training, like middle grade, staff grades and all that.
Well, it's great to have someone with so much knowledge and such an amazing background on the show. And just to finish, in your experience, very briefly, could you just maybe sum up a little bit in terms of a few golden rules, very, very quickly, that women can do to ensure they have better health?
Yeah, I would say that women have to sit on the driving seat, really, about their health. Because they are not only looking after themselves, their health, on their health depends the whole family. For example, if there's a prophet saying that if you educate one man, you have just educated one man. But if you educate a woman, you have educated the whole nation. So similar goes for the health. If you have a healthy woman, you have a whole healthy nation.
I love that. And I don't think we
can
even
apply
top
that.
I don't think we can top that. So thank you very much indeed. So there you have it. Some important and really helpful advice on female sexual health and the reproductive system, and of course hysterectomies. I'd like to thank Henna Rasool Khan and of course Saida Malik for coming into the show today and for giving us a better understanding on this subject. And if you'd like to know more, then as always, please do email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. And once again, we must stress that should you suffer from any medical problems, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as the Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. Join me next time when we'll be discussing gum disease with Dr. Hatem Al-Ghrafi. But for now, goodbye and we'll see you soon. Assalamu alaikum.